like IBG3, target market consists of companies between 100 crores to 1000 crores of sales turnover. He's also responsible for new client origination as well as existing portfolio management along with the segment focused liabilities. I request Mr. Ramaswamy to address us on the topic. On the topic, sorry, I'll make the topic as well. India macros and evolution of banking, SME perspective. Mr. Ramaswamy.
Hi, good afternoon to each one of you. So it's been a very enthralling session till now. And we've been speaking a lot about manufacturing excellence, right? So, and so you all will be wondering what's a bank doing and sponsoring something on manufacturing excellence, right? So essentially, the role of a bank, as Mr. Dave in opening conversation said, you know, the factors of production, land, labor, capital, and enterprise. So we spoke about land, the availability of large areas of land, and labor, how skilled you need the labor to be, how productive the labor can be, and the indomitable Indian entrepreneurial spirit which is already there, ingrained in our DNAs. So I take care of the capital part, right? So the bank is like blood to the body. So for whatever an entrepreneur endeavors to do, you need capital. Capital can come in the form of your own contribution, be it equity, your pooled in resources, or you go to lending institutions who lend money to you. And increasingly, banks have also undergone this change, or in the process of change based on you know, artificial intelligence, blockchain, and the traditional methodology of the way banks used to operate is actually getting challenged by the minute. So what we thought was, it was an apt forum for us to, you know, have a conversation with you all in terms of telling one, each one of you how banking is looking at embracing this change, what it means for a lot of customers, and especially the SMEs. So I've spent two decades catering to SMEs, and I've seen you know, how SMEs used to operate in the 90s before the internet and the mobile revolution came in. And how globalization took place. Now globalization is again going to a lot of localization, right? So in all this, how do we play a very crucial role? And to whatever we get up in the morning, you know, we see tweets, we see WhatsApps, there are a lot of news which flows, and news which forms views and then very strong opinions in this world. How do we as a bank look at India per se, right? So I thought we should give some time around that and spend some time around saying how do SMEs manage. One part is manufacturing excellence, but on the other part, excellence is managing their finances so that they get the best, right? So I'm not going to take more than 15-20 minutes. In case it's boring, in case it's more of a monologue, please raise your hand, I'll go to the next slide. So I'll have some 27 slides, but a lot of it is data. It'll help you all because you'll get some comparative idea about how India is faring vis-a-vis other countries. What are the right things which are being done? Because India as a country is going through a process of change. And change obviously is not always painless. There is some bit of pain, right? So okay, let me start. So we've got some long-standing strengths as a country. Okay, so what are these? So essentially, if you see, we've been speaking about a 5 trillion economy, and I think we're not doing bad at all as a country, right? So we are right there, US, China, Japan, Germany, India, UK, France. And if you compare GDP on the purchasing power parity, where your prices are in common, we are right up there. So I think to that extent, we're not doing a bad job. So at times we speak about GDP not being at 7%, we're used to saying 8% or 7%, it's gone down. But if you see the medium term, I mean, these are the numbers which are there. So two things, one is GDP growth and the quality of the GDP growth, right? So I think one is GDP is growing over time and the quality of GDP is also getting addressed so that all the sectors of the economy are benefited by this growth. Second, we have very young people. All of us are very young at heart. But even as they say, age is a number, we have young people, which means we have productive people, right? So this is giving you a comparison of the other Asian countries, how we stand. And again, it's not bad at all, right? So, And if you see some of the markets like Germany and Japan, really have a problem of an aging population, right? So we are right, doing well, but more importantly, when you have young people, you have aspirations, and you have to ensure you take care of aspirations. So it goes back to basics, right? Education, right? Value systems. So I think the investment in those kind of areas is what is going to determine the quality of our output. But yeah, we have talent which is young. Purchasing power, if you see, the income distribution is also improving. And you're seeing the middle class really broadening, and a lot of these guys are moving to the higher end of the category, especially people who have been able to use technology to build their own wealth, right? So the new age economy is really doing very well. So that's something which is really commendable what India has done. So how do we see India in 2020? Growth rate, so I'm not taking developed economies, I'm taking Asia per se, because that's something which is comparable, because a lot of Asia is developing. So if you see, we're not bad at all. I mean, the numbers are self-explanatory, and given the paucity of time, I don't want to dwell on each slide. So I'm just giving you a message that from a bank's perspective, right? So DBS Bank, we are an Asian bank, headquartered out of Singapore, 28% held by Temasek, and we'll understand Asia, right? So I mean, it's dealing with the gray at times, black, it's neither black nor white, we're somewhere between the two, right? So, and as a bank, we really feel that we have a very long standing commitment to India. We are one of the few foreign banks. I think there are only 2 out of 49 or 48 foreign banks who are wholly owned subsidiaries, which essentially means it's a locally incorporated entity versus being a branch of a parent. What does that mean? I can't run away, right? So capital repatriation and all can't happen. So it's a very, very long term commitment to the country. So why do we do that? Because we see, I think amidst all this, what is happening, the long term to medium term to long term is definitely there's a story which can get played out. There's a lot of coordinated policy action around the economy. We have seen some stresses in banks, we've seen stresses in non-bank finance companies, but those are situations which have played out, and obviously governance is something which is a key focus even for the government. And ill-governed or not so well-governed companies obviously have to deal with the new age of being governed and getting governed. So that's where excellence comes. So excellence, in my view, is not about having a patented technology, having your intellectual capability develop something. It's about a journey, it's about doing the right thing again and again and again. And governance and discipline plays a very important role there. So I think from that perspective, a lot of coordinated policy action in ensuring that not too much of bad money goes behind good money. You know, institutions have to bail themselves out, go and present to investors to say, you know, what went wrong, can you get more capital, right, on a standalone basis. And a lot of reform from GST, again, SMEs are going to be broadly benefited in the medium to long term, because a lot of this artificial intelligence and data we spoke about for an SME comes through, you know, the GST filings you do, and you get to know the kind of business volume an entrepreneur is doing. So the ability to raise capital is very, very transparent and quick. So taxation, you know what's happened in the last budget, and it's been a welcome change for many people. So our effective tax rates for corporates have gone down. So this is just an illustration of that. So I skipped this because it's a repetition. So this is very important, you know. So when we talk about the foreign currency, in USD, INR is a normal quoted foreign currency. So there are two ways of looking at it, right? So our fiscal over the medium to long term determines where the currency is headed. And in the tactical term, how much of foreign inflow comes in, how much of foreign exchange can be earned. For that, we have to be an attractive destination for foreigners to come and invest, right? So we heard MG Buddha speak, right? So SAIC coming into India, and a lot of other Chinese manufacturers coming into India, especially in the automobile space, where on one hand we say auto is really struggling, but if you see a Kia Motors or an MG Motors, they are sold bookings for 3 to 4 to 5 months. So at a price point, at a technology, at a quality, there is always a buyer. So if you see from a ease of doing business, we have really tremendously improved from 160, 142 to 163. And you know, FDI regulatory restrictiveness. How restrictive are we, or how bureaucratic are we in terms of managing foreign currency investments or interests? That's also substantially improved, which means it's easier for foreign companies than ever before to do business in India. FDI remains very robust. Yeah, the composition of FDI has changed because a lot of technology companies have, you know, got in a lot of FDI. If you see the Economic Times every day, there is some new tech company, some startup which is gaining or raising money. But again, that's where an opportunity for manufacturing, hardcore manufacturing, the way Germany, Mittelstand, they say, right? It's all about 70% of Germany's GDP is driven by family-run companies, which is the SME. They are the bread and butter, right? So I think that manufacturing excellence is what we speak about when we are in this conflict. And I think there is enough scope for manufacturing to attract foreign direct investment. So these are the sectors, how it's attracted, drugs, pharma, services in general. So that's where the FDI is coming in. So again, data. So these are the manufacturing sectors which have attracted FDI. And these are the service sectors. So I think what is the reform agenda, right? So essentially, more automatic approvals. FDI ceilings have been raised so that people can smoothly get in capital into the country. The endeavor to streamline tax system and the application process being simplified. All these are endeavors, right? So because we are a large country, you know, it's a democratic setup, so it takes time. I think that's how we see the positive in the entire policy action, where governance is kind of being the key motive, and seeking the support of states and the coordination between the center and the states. And very important is focusing on labor, upskilling labor, right? And the land reforms, which is something which is very critical. Again, alluding to what Dr. Dave just said in terms of land holding and acreage. So I think all this we know, we've read a lot about it in the news, but if you stitch all this together, I think the story comes out to be a positive. So if you see, summarizing, we have the strengths of size, people, purchasing power, and stable politics. And politics decoupled from the economic agenda. But yeah, there is some pain because, firstly, if you ask, the process of change has to undergo a painful process. And foreign portfolio remains upbeat, external vulnerability improved. So, which is why, with all this coronavirus, which is the latest thing now, plus a lot of riffraff across countries in terms of the way you want to put your weight around, I think your equity markets are signaling something else, right? So I think that's the best indicator of what the future is all about, because the discovering of future earnings is a function of how large investors look at a developing country like India based on structural reforms. So that was one part of my discussion in terms of how do we see the entire macros and why as a bank we are really so committed to India. And from 12 branches which we had in 20 years, in the last 1 year we've added more than 20 branches. And all our branches are SME branches. So, you know, an SME walks in with export documents, wants LC facilities, wants to process the documents, will not be rerouted to some central office. Each branch of DBS India will have the ability to cater to all the transactions of an SME. So I think that's the reason why we are here, and we want to grow. So the second part, any questions? It was too quick, but I'm sorry, I mean, there's a paucity of time. So this is the second part of what I wanted to speak to all of you all, is the evolution of the banking industry, right? So again, akin to a lot of industries, services follows manufacturing. If manufacturing doesn't do well, services doesn't do well, right? So, and the way evolution happens in manufacturing, services, because it's a shadow, has to follow the process of evolution. So banks were typically money lenders, right? So going and lending out money, and it was a nice business for all banks in the 80s, where customers had to queue up, waiting for their turn, putting up a proposal, and there was a hassle, and and there used to be a decision. So I think gone are the days, right? So today you see banking is nothing but a platform where there are capital providers on one end and customers needing capital on the other end, right? So, and it has become as transparent as it could have ever been. You have concepts of MCLR, the FX screens are available across portals. So it's become more of a utility than the help. So how do banks actually travel this entire journey of disruption? So if you see in the 90s is where the automation came, the ATMs came, the electronic fund transfer came, and the computerization came. And today, India in banking is one of the most advanced system when it comes to NEFT, RTGS, IMPS, 24/7. Even the developed countries in the world don't have such robust systems, right, the way India has. So to that extent, India has really come a very, very long way. So what does that mean for SMEs? Today, SMEs again have a situation where, you know, the promoter of the company does everything, right? From 10 to 11, he is the CFO. From 11 to 12, he is a production guy. From 2 to 3, he is a marketing guy. From 3 to 5, he is the HR guy. And then, you know, then there's some firefighting and then he goes home. So in that, what happens is, what we are trying to do as banks is solve the problem of the SME promoter by saying that, you know, we take care of your banking as a partner. You manage your business. So that's where banks are trying to head towards. For which, again, coming back to what Dr. Ramka said, you know, the excellence, which is a tool for survival, is required. Because if there is governance around companies, around disclosures, around the documents, around the P&L and the balance sheets, then it becomes all the more easier for banks to go and lend money out, right? Because a large part of what you all do, or what all banks do, is do a check on what is provided. If what is provided is extremely transparent, there's no need to check. Just think about the consumer retail business today of banks, right? There's a CIBIL score. That CIBIL score throws the number. And a bank decides the risk appetite. You know, some banks say about 650 we will lend, some banks say about 700 we will lend. What do? They do a KYC, they do your checks in terms of the CIBIL score and the money is in your bank account. I mean, there are institutions who lend in the same day, right? So just because there was transparency around the entire evaluation process, that has resulted in efficient deployment of capital to people who need money. And I personally believe that even in the SME space and the corporate space, it will happen in the same way, because we have a product for retail SME we just launched that I don't need financials for that. Only 12 months of bank statement is enough. So that's where you know the activity of a small enterprise, right? Financials is all data. So with 12 months of bank statement, we go and lend up to 5 million. But then that's so powerful for a small entrepreneur, because for an SME which is a 2 crore, 3 crore turnover, if he gets an order of 1 crore, that's a big jump. And if you do a traditional FPBA, going and taking tons of paper, by the time he gets the money, the order is lost. So I think it works both ways, and for SMEs, they really, really need to look at their entire thing from a professional standpoint. And I think banking will evolve in a way that it will be more of a capital provider and a partner rather than, you know, going and visiting them all the time. So today banks are there at the SME's doorstep. One last point I want to make here is, I think for SMEs, this is something which I thought through, and these are my views. I think the SME problem is again, you know, funding against property. So I don't know how many promoters are there here, or CFOs are there, or finance people. Today, the way banks look at life is how much collateral you have, and we give money according to that. I think that has to undergo a change where collateral is always finite. You can't have innumerable properties to be given to banks. Banks have to start evaluating customers on the strength of their business model, on the character of the promoter, and the kind of linkages you have, the kind of suppliers you have, the kind of customers you have. And then look at collateral, because banks only play on two wheels. One is the probability of default, whether the guy will go down. And if he goes down, what do I do to get the money out? But if you're able to focus correctly or appropriately on whether the guy will go down or not, then this question of collateral doesn't arise. So again, there the concept of governance, the concept of, you know, being transparent about life. And capital comes at a price. Suppose it's a very small guy, he's also taking a big risk, maybe the cost of credit comes at a slightly higher rate of interest as compared to a very well-evolved business, right? So risk-based pricing is something which is coming to India in a big way now, where the regulator is pushing banks to price risk appropriately. Because what we've seen in the news is a lot of big companies going down for various reasons, be it governance or others, but taxpayer money is going down the drain for no reason. Financial disclosure is very important because it helps the company in the long run. So the decision to make a small gain in the short term versus a peace of mind and ensuring that your organization goes through the long term is a choice which an SME or any other entrepreneur has to take. And I think investing in professional talent, at some point in time an SME has to decide that you can't play five roles in one day. It's just not possible, and then the span of control comes into picture, you can't grow. You'll remain an SME, right? Somewhere you have to take a call that, you know, if you have to go to other geographies, if you have to go to other states, there's no choice but to invest in professional talent and learn to manage them. It's like flying a kite. So the kite feels it's really independent in the sky, enjoying, but then the, you know, kite is being managed by you. So that's one way of managing, which a lot of globalized companies do. And you have to take a call, you know, what do you want to do? You want to be a regional player, you want to be a global player, or you want to be just in the domestic market catering to what you are. I mean, it's not that size is what matters. End of the day, it's your bandwidth, what you can really go ahead and do. And I think you have to embrace change, there's no choice. And as we all speak about manufacturing, distribution, services, technology is the common theme which is going to embrace everyone. And I think there is no escape from that. So that's about it. So I just thought I'd share some views on the macros and how we see the SME business going forward. Thanks a lot for your time.